On the waves I cast my net, no hint of what I'd get. No one knows how hard I tried. Oh, oh, I. Jesus called my name, said, follow me. Change my destiny. Called him Lord of creation. He called me Rock the Foundation. 'Cause I'm just beat in a stormy sea. I'd sink. Rebuke Christ's destiny to be crucified, divinity. I'm just beat when I seek first, Jesus says last. What will it take for him to see and not say, Satan, get behind me? Jesus showed how to forgive 70 times 7. Is it a crime when on the Sabbath he is healing? He's gonna be arrested soon. He says, I'll be fleeing. I'm no denier. Never met him, Jesus who?
Didn't you follow Jesus?
Don't know who this Jesus is.
I think you're a disciple.
Never even met this Jesus. Just Pete, not always strong, three times I'd flee. Yet he forgave me on a beach that Jesus set my soul free. I'm just Pete, where I felt shame, Jesus brought love. Now I stand tall, a fisher of men, answering his call. Killed for kingdom stuff. So hey, check me out. Yeah, I'm just Pete. My name's Pete and so am I. Put that Jesus hand in mine. So hey, world, check me out. Yeah, I'm just Pete.
I'm just Simon Peter. I began my journey with an abundant catch and a charge to drop everything and follow. With Jesus, I have walked on water and clung to him for rescue. I have pronounced my faith confidently, and I have been told to get out of Jesus' way. I have asked questions and learned about the expansiveness of grace, and now the end is near. I stand among the crowds as they sing songs of loudest praise. How will I respond? As Jerusalem buzzes with the energy of Passover, the air is thick with anticipation of the city swelling of pilgrims. I find myself in a whirlwind of emotion. Just weeks ago, Jesus called us aside, retreating out into the quietude of the wilderness, away from the clamoring crowds and the sharpening of knives by the empire. The air was heavy with danger after Jesus' friend Lazarus was brought back to life. Whispers of plots to arrest Jesus, and now Lazarus too, are impossible to ignore. We've witnessed the impossible. Lazarus walks among us, a man once bound by grave clothes, now sharing our meals. Jesus' power is undeniable, yet so is the hatred that he stirred. I hear you here too have had neighbors who hate you just because you're out there radically loving everyone. It's hard to understand. As we lingered in Bethany, I watched Mary anoint Jesus' feet, a lavish act of devotion that Judas scorned. Even then, amidst the fragrance of nard, tension simmered. Jesus spoke of his burial, his words veiled yet piercing haunted me. Now, as the gates of Jerusalem loom before us and the crowds gather, wielding palm branches like swords of victory, shouting, "Hosanna!" My heart is a battlefield. One does not simply walk into Jerusalem, especially not Jesus. Joy battles fear. Faith wrestles with doubt. The crowds see a king, a liberator from Roman oppression, but do they understand this kingdom that he speaks of? One not of this world, one that turns everything upside down. We should all understand by now. His mother, Mary, sang about it before his birth. She sang, "My soul is alive with the thoughts of God. What a wonder, their liberating works. Though the world has been harsh to me, God has shown me kindness, seen my worth, and called me to courage. From generation to generation, love's mercy is freely handed out. None are beyond the borders of God's transforming compassion. The power of God is revealed among those who labor for justice. God humbled the arrogant. God turned unjust thrones into dust. God's wisdom is revealed in the lives and truths of those who are on the margins. God is a feast for the hungry. God is the great redistributor of wealth and resources. God is the ceasing of excessive and destructive production so that all the earth, all the creatures and creations may praise him and all the earth might rest. Through exile and enslavement, famines and war, storms and violence from the oppressor, God is a companion in loss, a deliverer from evil, a lover whose touch restores. This is the promise God made to my ancestors, to me, to all the creatures and creations now and yet coming. And in this promise, I find my strength. Come, great healer, in flesh with us." Jesus is that God in flesh. This is not a kingdom we've ever experienced before. I'm swept up in the parade at his side, yet part of me lingers back in Bethany with his words about his death echoing in his mind. The people's praise is intoxicating. Their adoration is palpable, yet beneath the hosannas, I sense an undercurrent of danger, the sharp edge of Rome's watchful gaze, Caesar's simmering malice. As he mounts the donkey, fulfilling the words of the prophet, I can't help but marvel, this humble procession, this king on a donkey. Some even say a queen, because this parade had the pageantry of one of your drag shows, making fun of the patriarchy, making fun of Caesar on his big white horse, bringing his big Caesar energy. His donkey contrasts sharply with the conquerors that Rome parades through her streets. It's a declaration. This is a different kind of kingdom. They are supposed to be praising Caesar, but instead they're shouting for the one entering the city on a donkey. Their singing is subversive, courageous, and contagious. My chest swells with pride, yet a knot of fear tightens in my stomach. Is the world ready for this king? Are we, his disciples, ready? Are you ready for what comes next? I remember his rebuke after I dared suggest he should spare himself from suffering. Get behind me, Satan. His gaze, sharp and loving, silenced my fears, but didn't erase them. I wish I could shake the dread that grips me, the sense that we are walking into the heart of a storm. As the city gates engulf us, I'm torn between the exuberance of the moment and the shadow of his predictions. Today, I'll wave my palm branches, my voice joining with the chorus of hosannas. But what will I remember of this day, the joy of the crowd or the shadow of the cross that looms over us? The path ahead is murky, the outcome uncertain, but this moment, this day will be etched in my memory forever, not just for the shouts of praise and the spectacle, but for the silent glances exchanged among us, his disciples full of hope, fear, and unwavering loyalty. This is the day our King rode into Jerusalem, not to claim an earthly throne, but to walk the path of sacrifice. And I, Peter, though shaken, am honored to walk it with him. This is what I was made for. Well, that was Peter's journey. This is ours. How will we respond as a congregation, as individuals, when empire seems to be sharpening its knives for our own kin? We may not live in a time as barbaric as Rome, where they would hang the marginalized and freedom fighters on a cross, but we aren't far off. I want to introduce you to Heriberto Alejandro Sanchez Mayen. Mr. Sanchez Mayen was experiencing homelessness, sleeping in a box on an empty lot in St. Pete last June. Instead of calling officers who are trained to work with the homeless, two St. Pete police officers seemingly took joy in arresting him when no arrest was warranted. He asked, "Are you gonna write me a ticket?" And the female officer said, "No, we're gonna give you a little ride." He was calm and compliant. They handcuffed him in the back of a metal death trap and gave him what police call the rough ride. Slamming on the brakes, speeding up fast, you can watch the video online, it is horrific. You can watch Mr. Sanchez Mayen slam headfirst into the metal wall, being thrown from the back to the front of the cage, treated like an animal. He was paralyzed. You can watch the officer drag him out of the metal cage and slam his head on the concrete. This was the second time this officer driving had an offense of injuring a man who was homeless in the cage. He did it a year before this as well. No disciplinary action. Both these officers are still on patrol. Meanwhile, Mr. Sanchez Mayen has had his legs amputated. This harm to Mr. Sanchez Mayen is what happens when our laws at the state level and at our city level dehumanize the unhoused. Some of our police feel emboldened, almost it's permission giving to act this way. It's a modern day attempted lynching. Liberation theologian James Cone wrote, "The cross and the lynching tree interpret each other. Both were public spectacles, shameful events, instruments of punishment reserved for the most despised people in society. Jesus died like a lynched black victim or a common black criminal in torment on a tree of shame. The crowd's shout, 'Crucify him,' anticipated the white mob's shout, 'Lynch him.' Jesus' agonizing final cry of abandonment from the cross, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' was similar to the lynch victim Sam Hose's awful scream as he drew his last breath, 'Oh my God, oh Jesus.' In each case, it was a cruel, agonizing, and contemptible death. The cross can heal and hurt. It can be empowering and liberating, but also enslaving and oppressive. There's no one way in which the cross can be interpreted, and I offer my reflections because I believe that the cross placed alongside the lynching tree can help us see Jesus in America in a whole new light, and thereby empower people who claim to follow him to take a stand against white supremacy and every kind of injustice. So how will we respond? Like Peter? Like Peter, will we choose this moment to sound like Trump on the witness stand? Jesus never knew the man. Or will we stand with the Mr. Sanchez Mayans of the world right here in our own neighborhood? The choice is before us. And may God have mercy on the church if we choose to flee. We are God's plan of salvation and liberation. There is no one else coming. And we know that this isn't where the story ends. That cross gives way to liberation. That God in flesh in us calls us to radical solidarity with Mr. Sanchez Mayan. Will we say yes today?